Hello friends, so in the previous video we have completed our discussion on intrinsic materials, right? So what was an intrinsic material? An intrinsic material is a material which is refined to such levels that it has very less amount of impurity, like the impurity will be one part in almost 10 million. Okay, so then we saw about the concept of the energy bands, right? Energy levels. Then we saw that there is valence band, there is conduction band, and in between the valence band and conduction band there is something which is called a band gap or a forbidden gap, where no electron can exist. And we saw that there is an energy associated here, which is called the band gap energy, which is represented by the letter Eg. And what was that value? That value is the amount of energy. Eg is the amount of energy that a valence electron has to acquire, minimum that much amount of energy it has to acquire, so that it can go to the conduction band or it can become a free electron. So that is what we have seen in the previous video. Then we saw that for insulators, the band gap energy is very high. For conductors, the conduction band and valence band are overlapping each other. And for semiconductors, you saw that the valence band is not separated from the conduction band by a huge value of band gap energy. Okay. So now today we will see something which is called N-type and P-type materials, or we will call them as extrinsic materials. We saw intrinsic materials in the previous video. So these are called extrinsic materials. Now intrinsic materials are ultra pure. So naturally, extrinsic materials will be something where you are adding some kind of an impurity to serve your purpose. Okay, not randomly adding impurities, a particular amount of impurity, a particular type of impurity, so that it will serve a proper purpose. So there are two types, which is N-type and P-type. Okay, so we are always telling about pure, ultra pure. We need very pure intrinsic material of silicon, germanium, gallium arsenide, etc. But what is the importance of this purity? When you are having a pure material, when you are having a very pure material, you can modify its characteristics drastically by adding a specific type of impurity to it. So that is why you need a very high pure crystal of silicon or germanium. Because only in this high pure type of material, if you add a specific impurity, you can vary the characteristics of that high pure material, the electrical characteristics specifically, to a drastic amount when you add an impurity. Okay. So I will just write down that point. The characteristics of a semiconductor, the characteristics of a semiconductor can be altered significantly by the addition of specific impurities, not any impurities, I already told you. Or specific impurities to the relatively pure semiconductor. So this is the importance of this intrinsic type of material, to relatively pure semiconductor. Okay, and usually the impurity concentration might be 1 in 10 million. Okay, so one part of impurity in 10 million parts of the intrinsic semiconductor. Okay, so these impurities are 1 in 10 million. 1 in 10 million also can drastically change the electrical properties of the material. So I'm just writing down this point so that you can take down and you can make your own notes also. Now this process of adding the impurity to an intrinsic material is called doping. Okay, so any material which has been subjected to the process of doping is called an extrinsic material. Okay, so a semiconductor that has been subjected to the process of doping is called an extrinsic material. Extrinsic material. So these definitions are very important because these form the fundamental basics of understanding the basic semiconductor, which is only what you require for a power electronics course. Now extrinsic materials are of two types. One is called the P-type material. Okay, the other is called the N-type material. We will see both these type of materials in this particular video. So let us first take the N-type material. Let me first remove this. because we will be seeing this diagram a lot. So we'll just start by writing what is an n-type material, n-type semiconductor. Now, to this silicon structure, which you have just seen now, for example, this, you already seen this, right? This is the silicon structure that we have seen. So this is the silicon structure, crystalline structure. So you are having the covalent bonds present here, okay? So when do you get an n-type material? You get an n-type material, or an n-type material is created by the addition of impurity elements. Addition of impurity elements that have 5 valence electrons. Silicon has how many valence electrons? 4 valence electrons. But the impurity that you add to make an n-type material will have 5 valence electrons. Okay, that have 5 valence electrons. This is a very important point. Such materials are called pentavalent impurities. Pentavalent in the sense, because they have 5 valence electrons. I think we have already seen tetravalent, pentavalent and trivalent. I have given the basic definition. Now, what are the examples of such impurities? Okay, so one impurity is antimony. This has 5 valence electrons. Then you are having phosphorus. Phosphorus has an atomic number of 15. And then you are having arsenic. Okay, now what does this impurity actually do? Okay, so when you introduce the impurity in such kind of a silicon structure, when you introduce an impurity in such kind of a silicon structure, I'll just take it to the other side so that you will have a better understanding. Okay, yeah, so this is better. So when you introduce a material like phosphorus, for example, you are having phosphorus here. So phosphorus, it has 5 valence electrons. Okay, it has 5 valence. Silicon has 4 valence electrons. So when you are introducing this impurity by some process, it will replace some of the silicon atoms. Not all the silicon, because the concentration is very less, right? So it will replace some of the silicon atom depending upon how much you are doping the material. And as usual, what will happen? I will just represent the phosphorus with a different color here. So this silicon atom will be displaced by this phosphorus. Okay, so this is your phosphorus which is going to come here. So this phosphorus. Now phosphorus has 4 valence electrons. So we'll mark that. So this is 4 valence electrons, and they will naturally form the covalent bond with the silicon. It has formed the covalent bond with the silicon. But you know that phosphorus has 5 valence electrons. So one, this has formed a covalent bond. This has formed covalent bond. But this does not have an area to form a covalent bond. Okay, so this is like a free electron, because only 4 electrons are needed to form the covalent bond. So the fifth electron is actually free. And this is like a free electron. Why it is a free electron? Because it is loosely bound to the atom. It is very loosely bound to the atom, and it is relatively free to move within the crystalline structure because it does not have a covalent bond, right? It does not have to gain the energy to break the covalent bond, right? How the free electrons are created, the valence electron will absorb certain amount of energy so that it can come out of the influence of the atom and they can behave like free electron. But this is already not in part of a, it is very loosely bound to the atomic structure, okay? So it is much more easier, very little amount of energy is required for this to become a free electron, okay? Of course, it is always bound to the atom. Only when it gains a little bit of energy, it becomes a free electron. That is always there. That you will understand when you see the energy band diagram. But that amount of energy is very, very small. Even in room temperature, easily that is achievable. Okay. So what are the effects of this impurities? We will write down. The effects are just what I have discussed till now. So the first effect is that the four covalent bonds are made. So 1, 2, 3, and 4. 4 covalent bonds are already made. Okay. Then the additional fifth electron. Due to the impurity, where did this electron come from? It came from this phosphorus, which is the impurity, right? Due to the impurity, atom is present, which is unassociated with the covalent bond. Okay, unassociated with the covalent bonds. with the covalent bonds. Okay, why I am writing this points wise is because so that you get some technical terms in understanding all these things. Okay, when I am explaining it is one way, but then if you have some technical terms like this, it will be much more easier for you to revise. Okay, so the additional fifth electron, due to the impurity atom is present, which is not associated with the covalent. It is not part of the covalent bond. Okay, that is what we are trying to say here. Okay, now what is the characteristic of this electron? This electron is loosely bound to the atom. Okay, and is relatively free to move. Within the what material? Within the newly formed material. See, what is an n-type material? You are taking the intrinsic material and you are adding impurities to it. So it is not the old intrinsic material which you are having. It is a new material. Okay, within the new material. Now, who gave this free electron? The free electron was given by this particular phosphorus atom, right? This pentavalent impurity had given the free electron. So it is just like it is donating a free electron to the atomic structure. Intrinsic material also has some free electrons based on the temperature, but that is, you know, that the carrier concentration we have seen in the previous video. But now here, due to the addition of this particular pentavalent impurity, you are having an electron. You are having a free electron which can go into the conduction band if you give a little amount of energy. Okay, so it is like this is donating a free electron. Okay, so these types of pentavalent impurities are called, or these types of pentavalent atoms are called donor impurities. Okay, donor impurities are donor atoms. Okay, so I'll write that here. The impurity donates a free electron. And therefore they are called donor atoms. Therefore, the pentavalent impurities, usually you refer to them as donor impurities, or the atoms associated, you call them as donor atoms. Okay, so this is very important. So I hope you have understood this thing. Okay? Now we will just see the energy levels. What happens in the energy level? As usual, you know that in the energy level, so if you draw a drawing like this, so this is the energy. So this is the energy direction, and you know that this will be the nucleus direction. So the further the electron is away from the nucleus, the more energy it is associated with. So here you are having your valence band. This is the valence band. We saw that the valence band has discrete energy levels. We saw this in the previous video, right? Okay, we're just revising a little bit of revision. And then you are having the conduction band. Okay, this is the conduction band. The conduction band also might have discrete energy levels. That is why it is called a band. It is not a single level. It has discrete energy levels. Okay. Now, when you add a donor impurity, another energy level comes into the existence. Okay. So this is the forbidden gap. Or it is also called as the band gap. So what did we see in the previous video? The electrons in the intrinsic material will have to acquire this much amount of energy. To jump from the valence band to the conduction band. So this is what we have seen in the previous video. Now what happens is that another level will come. Which is representing these free electrons. These free electrons were not there initially in the intrinsic material. It came after doping. So another level will come into existence to represent the free electrons. Okay. So I will write down that a discrete energy level called the donor level, appears in the forbidden gap, okay. Let us draw that note. So this is the discrete energy level that comes in the forbidden. Okay, and it came due to the impurity. Now here you see the band gap energy is so low. This Eg value is so low that even in room temperature, a large amount of these type of free electrons, can move in from this band to the conduction band. So when does the atom, when is the electron ready for conduction, or it can contribute to conduction, it is when it comes to the conduction band. From here to here, it is considerably a large amount of energy, right? You have to give external thermal or light energy. From here to here, from the valence band to reach conduction band, you have to give external energy like thermal energy or light energy. But here, the band gap is so low that even at room temperature, a lot of electrons can jump from this level, this donor level. You can call it as the donor level. Donor level. It is easier for them to jump from the donor level to the conduction band. Why? Because the band gap energy associated is so low. What is band gap energy? It is that energy which minimum an electron should achieve to reach from a particular level to the conduction band. This band gap energy is so low. Okay, so easier for the electrons to go. So we will write down that the Eg of the donor level, Eg of the donor level is much less as compared to the intrinsic material. The intrinsic material, you did not have this donor level. You had only valence band and conduction. Sorry. Okay. So we will just write down that point also here. The electrons in the donor level, have less difficulty in absorbing sufficient energy, okay, to move into the conduction band. These points are like very important when you just understand certain devices. So that is why I am spending some time to understand the basics. Okay, so I have told you in room temperature itself a lot of materials will move. So we will just see what is the change in carrier concentration. Okay, now in intrinsic material, the intrinsic silicon, for example, let's take silicon. There is one free electron for 10 power 12 atoms. Usually that is the case. I told you in intrinsic material, when you give some energy, thermal energy, when it absorbs thermal energy, you get a free electron. So that measure is roughly one free electron for 10 power 12 atoms. Okay. Now, when you have a dosage level, or when you do a doping of 1 in 10 million, that is, the doping level is 1 atom of phosphorus in 10 million atoms of silicon, which is 10 power 7. So you can clearly see, if you do a simple calculation here, the increase, and you know that one donor atom will give one free electron, right? One donor atom will give you one free electron, right? So the increase in carrier concentration, if you take a ratio, it will be clearly 10 power 12 divided by 10 power 7, or that will be equal to 10 power 5. So the ratio of carrier concentration, okay, or you can tell the increase in carrier concentration is this much, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, yeah. So it is around 1 lakh is to 1. Okay, so this is also very important. So by adding just one part of one part of the pentavalent impurity, you have increased the carrier concentration this much. Okay, so that is the very important. So 10 power 5 amount of carrier concentration you have increased. Okay, so that is the basic idea here. So with this, let us conclude our discussion on the n-type material. In the next video, we will start our discussion on p-type material, and then we will do a comparison. Then we will define terms like majority carriers, minority carriers, etc., and we will understand the device a little bit more. So till I see you in the next video, it's me Varun signing off, and have a great day. Thank you.
Now that the video is over, please stay with me for 30 more seconds. Now, the vision of this channel is to create a repository of good quality videos with crystal clear explanation regarding various topics related to electrical engineering. Now, if you want to help me spread the word, please share this video with anyone interested in these topics. The second thing is that for me, education is a two-way process. Therefore, if you have any doubts or suggestions regarding any of the videos or regarding the channel, please put them in the comments below. We can have a healthy discussion, and that way we can build a strong community of electrical engineers. So that's it for today's video. So till I see you in the next time, it's me Varun signing off, and have a great day. Thank you.